We viewed each of these threats separately, but unfortunately, these things are often acting together, and we get then cascading effects. Now, in some regards, what we're seeing is that we are always dealing with a natural system that has a large number of interacting parts. And so the livelihood of, say, this insectivore depends on the number of insects around, but then the plants that feed the insects. So all these species depend on each other in some way. And some species are obligate. If they lose that partner, they're in deep, deep trouble. So we can see this with pollinators. If this bee were to disappear, this plant could no longer set seed and would go extinct. Now, let's look at pollinators because they're such an integral part of so many ecosystems. We have a lot of bees that occur naturally in the system, but we also use them in agriculture. And a lot of people manage bees in order to help with the pollination of crops. So you might see these apiaries, or these bee colonies, that are kept around various farms in Minnesota and other places. And if you're to look inside these drawers, there are combs, and they're being tended by the workers, honey's produced, life is great. And this is what a healthy colony looks like, and they're going out, getting the pollen, bringing back the nectar and the pollen to feed their young, everybody's great. Now, it's a very important component of a lot of agricultural systems to have bees delivered to them during the breeding season for the plant, or the flowering season. Most conspicuous is in their almond crops. These pictures are from California, where bees have been brought from as far away as North Dakota and Minnesota to bring pollinators who can get the pollen in the trees to each other, fertilize them so you can have almonds, and then the bees are carried on somewhere else. So, happy bees, lots of pollen, lots of nectar, everything's great. Unfortunately, in the last few years, there's been a new threat to the viability of our agricultural system because the bees upon which we rely are subject to what's called colony collapse disorder. And this is currently killing about 30% of all hives every year. And when a colony gets colony collapse disorder, these otherwise normally healthy combs look disgusting. The bees get really sick, they have diarrhea, the pupae aren't being looked after properly, they all start to rot, it's disgusting, and the entire colony disappears, and this is all you see that's left. Bees are important sentinels of ecosystem health. Bees interact with plants, bees live amongst other insects. Now, farmers like bees, but they don't like most other insects because the other insects eat their crops. So most farmers rely on pesticides to spray their fields against herbivorous insects. But those same pesticides are infecting or affecting the health of the bees. And so this is a sample of pollen taken from some beehives here in Minnesota. And it turns out that the pollen that's being brought back to the babies in the nest contains a wide variety of insecticides. All these different names here are different kinds of pesticides. They're being brought back to the hive by the bees. The bees' wax in the hive is kind of a repository for a lot of the material brought back by the workers. And very common, 100% of combs that were looked at had this particular pesticide, 100% had this one, and so on. Again, a large number of different pesticides coming back to the nest and being integrated into the system. And these are poisons that are not good for the bees at all. Furthermore, bees are suffering from a remarkable drop in nutrition. Bees like a lot of different kinds of pollen. In a traditional garden, you'd have a variety of different crops. The bees might circulate from one crop to the next, and they'd bring back lots of different proteins that they get from those different pollens. So this is a healthy hive where the pollen is coming back from a variety of different plants, and the pollen's different colors. Again, healthy bees. With modern agriculture, farmers specialize on either corn or soybeans here in the Midwest. So you have vast fields with just one crop. That means just one kind of pollen. So the bees are only getting a very simple diet. And the pollen from just one species may not have all the essential nutrients to produce healthy new workers in the next generation. Now, a third big problem for bees is that they have been subjected to infection by an invasive species of mite. This hideous looking thing here has a Latin name, Varroa destructor, and it's also known in some circles as the vampire mite. And this got into American bees in 1987. It came over from Asia, so it's one more invasive species like the Asian carp, zebra mussels, and all those. Now, these mites are bloodsuckers, and so they attach themselves to the workers, and they're drawing off vital fluids from the worker. And they also attend with the worker to the hive, and some of the mites will fall off and drop onto a developing pupa. So now you've got a pupa that is being sucked on by one of these wretched mites. They then grow up and they emerge, and they'll help to keep spreading the mite around the colony. Now, these are not good things for the health of the colony. Infection with these mites reduces their body weight because they've been losing nutrients. They don't live as long. Infection also suppresses their immune system, and this is a vector, and this can spread viruses from one colony to the next. So Varroa has been very destructive indeed to bee colonies. So we've looked at these various different components. We've had invasive species like Varroa, the vampire mite. We've got pollution, so we've got all these pesticides that are ordinarily the farmer's friend in killing grasshoppers and other pests, but they're coming back to the beehives. There's also a loss of biodiversity in their diet, so much simpler nutritional plane. And now, in addition to all this, there are new viruses and new parasites that are appearing within these weakened colonies. So altogether, you have collapse. Each one of these by itself might have been okay, the colony might survive, but you add them all together and you get a cascading effect on the health of the entire colony. Yikes. Let's look one more time at the five great extinctions in history. Let's start with the end of the Triassic at 205 million years ago. Catastrophic geological events led to the extinction of 76% of terrestrial species. However, this opened up brand new ecological opportunities for the dinosaurs, and they became the dominant land animals and remained so for the next 150 million years until the end of the Cretaceous at 66 million years ago, when asteroid and volcanoes wiped them out all at once. But then that led to an opening for the mammals. And if we look at the size of mammals prior to this Cretaceous die-off, they were quite small, less than 20 pounds, 10 kilos or so. But once the dinosaurs were gone, there was an ecological niche available for really large animals, and the mammals eventually grew to replace them as the largest animals on Earth. This ancient relative of a rhino was as big as any dinosaur. These dominated until humans came along and drove so many of those large species to extinction. So we're now at this last, most recent event. And one thing I want to show you before we leave this whole topic is that when the Triassic ended, with the breakup of Pangaea, all those greenhouse gases caused a 3-degree rise in global temperature. That's it. Today, with all the fossil fuels that we're putting into the atmosphere, and have already put into the atmosphere, the Earth's temperature is very likely to rise at least 4 degrees Celsius. The impacts of our industrial revolution and our overall influence on the world are so profound that we're likely to lead to an enormous, enormous extinction event that may dwarf all those that have ever been recorded before. Now, even though this sounds pretty horrible, from the long-term view, in terms of life on Earth, there will be survivors. Just like the dinosaurs survived the breakup of Pangaea, and the mammals survived the asteroid strike of 66 million years ago, something will survive this, and there'll be new lineages that will replace whatever we see today. Could be cockroaches. I mean, what can get rid of cockroaches, right? And hey, rats, they do really well. Look at this. This is in India, And already, I mean, rats kind of take over in very disturbed ecosystems. What'll happen when we've destroyed the Earth? Maybe they'll have a great new lineage and you'll have monster rats as big as dinosaurs 100 million years from now. Who knows? Hey, and pigeons, you know? The passenger pigeon was a pretty delicate flower, as it turned out, but these pigeons in the park, they're really difficult to get rid of, so maybe they'll survive and they'll be 30-foot long pigeons 100 million years from now. Who knows? For sure, there'll be the bacteria. Nothing can get rid of the bacteria. They will persist. Life will continue, no matter how awful our impacts are on this planet. Oh, but wait, what about us? Aren't these implications pretty serious for our own future? What I've been trying to show you is that we're only now beginning to appreciate the magnitude of the global environmental crisis. This is why everybody is so concerned about the implications of continuing as we have done over the last century. 50 million years from now, maybe some giant pigeon will talk to some giant rat, and they'll look back upon the age of humans, back on the sixth great extinction.